Welcome to Commonwealth Politics. I'm Mark Kemper, and I'm here with Brian Frederick from the Political Science Department, and we're hosting a show on women and political leadership. And our guest today is Representative Patricia Haddad, who is the Speaker Pro Temp of the Massachusetts State House of Representatives. Representative Haddad represents the town of Dighton and Somerset and portions of Taunton and Swansea. So we're here to talk about political leadership, and I want to thank you very much for showing up.
And I'm very happy to be here.
Thank you. All right, thanks for being here as well. One of the major issues that's generated a lot of attention during the legislative session that's particularly, I think, of interest to a lot of women is the Pregnant Workers Fairness Act. Didn't go very far in the previous session of the legislature, but it appears that the odds of passage are much greater this time. Could you talk a little bit about some of the progress on that legislation?
Sure. Whenever we do a piece of legislation that affects businesses, we have to look at, while everybody would say, oh, of course we're going to be fair to women, and of course we want pregnant women to be able to work as long as they possibly can, we also have to look at what that means to businesses, because there's a lot of small businesses out there. We're not, you know, not all the Amazons and the big banks. There's regular people. So for several years, or several sessions, actually, a couple of the women would file this Pregnancy Fairness Act, and there were times when it would appear that making accommodations would could substantially hurt a business, or could cause that business to have downtime. So last session, there was a feeling that it was time to really take a good look at this, and it came out of the committee and passed right along. And then at the end of the session, a couple of the women, one from the Senate and one from the House, sat down with AIM, Associated Industries of Massachusetts, which is a very large organization that represents a lot of different sized businesses, but a lot of very small businesses. And the group really spent a great deal of time talking about what is a common sense accommodation. So everybody will laugh, but, you know, having been pregnant in my life, there are times when your weight is significantly increased, which leads to, you know, making you tired, your balance is off. So if you have a larger parking lot, making an accommodation that a pregnant woman could be closer to the building. It's not a disability, but it is a way of saying, yep, we get it, you know. Takes a longer time for you to get there. Other things like postpartum, when some women really, really have to get back to work. I mean, every family has to be able to live, but they want to continue to nurse their child. So a private space that's not a ladies' room, where they can go to express milk and keep going on this very important, which we try to encourage people, this very important natural part of having a child. So they sat down with the businesses, and the AIM, you know, said the same thing. We agree, but how do we make this so it's not a burden on our small businesses? And how, you know, we can't be saying to somebody, well, you have to put aside a whole room. What's a reasonable accommodation? So that went very well, and so it was so close at the end, but we just didn't, the time ran out. Unfortunately, there's a clock on everything we do. So it's been heard again. It was heard just last week, and we have, you know, we really feel that it's going to go forward very quickly. And it is, it will be, I'm sure, endorsed by lots of businesses. And I think that's very important in the grand scheme of things, because our small businesses are responsible for many more jobs than our larger businesses.
Where's Charlie Baker on? Has he said what he'll do if it is presented to him?
Yes. You know, because of the work, it's interesting that the administration's role is, of course, is to weigh in all throughout the process, but watch that the process really is fair and balanced. And so I believe the governor, I won't speak for him, but I think that the process has been so comprehensive that he will be able to feel that he can endorse the bill and sign it right away.
So at the moment, there isn't any law or policy placing any kind of restrictions or obligations on employers provide any kind of accommodation whatsoever.
Correct. And, you know, some of the larger businesses do. They just do it because they have the ability. And, you know, they've been doing it all along.
And it's probably good for employee morale.
It's very good for employee morale. It's good to keep your workers engaged, you know, less time, more time on task, less time out for whatever the reason. But we were particularly concerned about what this meant for small businesses. And so that work has been done, and it's, you know, we're going forward in the process.
And many other states already have a law similar to this on the books, right?
Mm-hmm. New York, I think, just adopted, or the New York legislature, I think, adopted one a couple of years ago. What agency will be responsible for administering or enforcing this law, or will it be done through actions being brought in the courts, or what's the enforcement mechanism?
Well, the Attorney General enforces all of these things, but it'll go through you know, the small business department or agency, and you know, I don't anticipate, usually when there's this much input from all sides, I don't anticipate a lot of problems. The other thing that many, like the Chambers of Commerce, AIM, they'll do, you know, small little classes or how to implement or how can we help you. Nobody wants to, you know, hurt anybody. So they'll have those opportunities for people to figure out. Similar to what we did with the equal pay.
Yes.
So.
And how long after the birth of a child, in terms of, you know, you mentioned, you know, after the birth, you know, breastfeeding and things like that, or pumping milk, is there a timeline on when this expires after birth, or is it as long as the...
I think that is, you need to leave that up to, that's a hard thing.
The individual relationship.
Right. Yeah. The individual relationship between the woman, her employer. You know, naturally, we don't want to see somebody go on for years. No offense. But, you know, the realities are that we know that a certain number of months. And so everything has been based on the science. You know, what's the thought process behind what a healthy pregnancy, what helps a healthy pregnancy? What are the common sense accommodations that would help the beginning of a life, the healthy life of a child? So it's all based in science and research, and then the relationship between the two parties.
So there's no termination date postpartum in terms of when this expires. That's left open.
That's left a little open.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Stepping back a little bit and thinking about the big picture here in Massachusetts, how would you assess the progress that has been made in terms of female representation in the legislature, and how do you think that that's translated into better public policy outcomes, both overall and for women specifically?
So, do you have a day?
Yeah.
That's a huge topic, and as you can imagine, it's something that we think about quite often. So, first and foremost, we in Massachusetts are just a little bit better in terms of percentages than nationally. Nationally, I think we're at nearly 24%, but in Massachusetts, we're at 26%. It's a huge question. How do you make women understand that the contributions they bring are good? They're good in businesses. You know, there's research that shows that the number of women on a board and the number of women in an executive suite contribute greatly to the success of a business. It's true whether it's a local board or whether you're at the legislature. Every legislature is supposed to be representative of the people of, in this case, the Commonwealth. 50, you know, sometimes more than 50% of the people in a state or in an organization are women. So in order to try to make sure that you're representative of your group, we try to encourage women. But it's very funny. Women are their own worst enemy. They have to be asked many more times to run than a man does. The research says 7 times a woman has to be asked. Very often, a woman will question her qualifications more than a man. Fundraising, raising money is always one of those things that you'll go and you'll raise thousands of dollars for a PTO or a nonprofit or some good cause, but when it comes to raising money for yourself, women shy away from it. So all of those, the roles that we somewhat impose upon ourselves, we need to push them aside and remind people that they're very capable. And we know that we need to work hard, so we do a good job.
Your path to the State House led, as it does for many, through local government,
yes.
Service in local government.
Mm-hmm.
Is that sort of the path that you think is the way to encourage women to get involved, serve at the local level first?
I think women, more often than men, find their path through the local. We have lots of men who went right into the legislature. But women seem to find their path more often through being a select person, a councilor, a mayor, a school committee person. Something in their municipality that gives them the courage or the confidence to say, oh, I did it on that scale, I can do it on the larger scale. So yes, that is one of the things. You'll also find that women get involved because of an issue, because there's something in particular that they wanted to try to affect. And it was, it's true at the local level and it's true at the state level as well. And again, that's different from a man, because a man will see a big picture and say, I can affect that big picture as well.
Well, you're in a leadership position in the State House. How do you think that the differences between men and women translate in terms of the types of leadership styles and approaches that they take based on your experience?
Well, I think I can only really speak to my style, but it seems that there are some things that can be attributed to women in general. A lot of my style was sort of conceived because I played sports, and I had only brothers. So the only people that were around were the guys, the boys to play with. I think that plays a very big role. We did an informal poll, and then I think Forbes did a more formal poll that more women seek higher positions who have played team sports, which I think is really, really interesting. I think it bears out in the way we do things. We do very often do things as a committee, as a team, as a collaboration. You seek out. I always seek out people who know more than I do. That's a lot of people, by the way. But you seek out the people who know more than you do. You, just as you would a coach, you learn from them. You apply the techniques that you've learned. And I think men tend to be more comfortable being the point guard or being the quarterback. I'm very comfortable playing the line. I don't mind butting heads, but I want that to be constructive. I don't want there to be conflict for the sake of conflict. I want there to be conflict for the sake of resolution. And so I think that's the way I see a lot of my women colleagues work. We enjoy working together, and we enjoy seeing the fruits of those labors, and we certainly think that it's a benefit to be able to bring people together. So it's enjoyable. You see results immediately when you put some people together and you start to see the consensus building. And I think in general, that's how you will find most women work.
Now, I know you're a member. Is it the Massachusetts Women's Political Caucus? I got the name wrong.
I'm the member of the Mass Women's Political Caucus, which is a nonprofit group who helps women from both parties, it's nonpartisan, get elected. But I'm also a member of the Mass Women's Legislative Caucus. And that was started about 40 years ago when there were very few women. And so, and going back 40 years, I'm pretty sure there was no ladies' room in the chamber area. So that was one of the things that had to get done. But it was a group of women who, just sort of worked together. And we've stayed together in order to mentor other women, in order to, promote an agenda of sorts. And it's interesting because over the years we've found that the agenda or items that you would consider women's items have morphed into more family items. You'll see a lot more legislation that is around small businesses or around making us stronger as families. And so it's not so much a women's caucus, although, you know, we stick together for the camaraderie. It's more of a how do we get some good things done and put together some women who happen to think it's a good idea.
As a elected representative, and do you find that you have women and even girls coming to you saying that you're an inspiration, that they see that you and your colleagues are in elected government and that someday they could envision themselves in that role as well?
You know, it's a little embarrassing, but it is true. You know, again, going back to the research shows that people want to see themselves mirrored, whether it be in their bosses or their legislature. So whether you're a person of color, whether you are a female, you want to see people like you doing things. And so I very often get to speak to, you know, everything from Girl Scout groups to college groups to, you know, small political organizations. And it's so flattering when I'll have young women come to me and say, can I just talk to you for 15 or 20 minutes about where I'm going? And, you know, try to give a little advice, you know, keep your options open, all of those things. So I'm shy about it, but it's one of the really, really nice things that I get to do.
In terms of substantive policy, right, we mentioned earlier the agenda and talking about agenda with the women's caucuses. What are some of the issues right now that you think are really important at the state level affecting women in Massachusetts that the state legislature is considering that maybe you're involved with in terms of sponsoring or just that you know is on the table?
Well, there's a little bit of, I don't know how to really describe it, but there's a feeling out there, a little different feeling that we have noticed that is less respectful of women. And I don't want to, you know, point to anything in particular, but we have found of late that things that had been considered pretty regular types of respect that we, you know, that we would give to men, not in the legislature, by the way, but outside, is not being returned in the same way. You know, we're finding, the women and I have talked about, that we're finding that Facebook is a little rougher than it has been. And so, you know, we have a pretty thick skin, but so we're looking into some of those things, you know, around Planned Parenthood. You know, there's been a lot of talk about money being taken from Planned Parenthood.
With President Trump's proposed
budget,
right?
Yes. Right. Now, I'm not sure that people actually realize that Planned Parenthood is not just about women, that Planned Parenthood is actually about underserved population, and that includes males. The Planned Parenthood is also about preventative things like mammograms, and that such a small portion of it is actually about the thing that that is so controversial, and that's abortions. And it's somewhere around 10%, maybe less. But the important thing is that Planned Parenthood serves a purpose in the Commonwealth, in that it is the agency through which money is filtered in order to make sure that our low-income people are served. And whether they are young and actually thinking about planning a family or delaying planning a family, it tends to be a joke, but it's very true. It's about old broads like me who don't have the money to go to a very expensive doctor. And they go to these clinics and make sure that all of those preventive services that we have to worry about as we get older are taken care of. So we're very concerned about that. We're looking at that. The governor has also said that he wants to make sure that we continue to fund Planned Parenthood. Now, levels are always the question because we have a budget. We're not the federal government. We can't print money, and we have to stay within the budget that is supplied to us. So that's going to be one of those things that we're going to have to look very, very closely at, and not just in terms of women, but what it means for families.
So are you encouraging federal representatives from Massachusetts in Congress and in the Senate to support continued funding so that it won't come down to the legislature having to be the guarantor of that money?
Yes, and you know, that is such an important point. We will not be able to fill all the gaps if all of the what-ifs come crashing down on us. So we are very much, all of us have great relationships with our personal congressmen, with the senators. And they have, my congressman happens to be Congressman Kennedy. He's been very, very aggressive in making sure that that the administration knows what's important to the state of Massachusetts. That kind of brings me into another place where we're working right now. We have a special committee in the House, and that committee is looking at what could potentially happen with regard to the federal government. So we have a committee that's being very flexible. We are able to look into the committees and see if there is a piece of legislation that will be able to solidify and codify the beliefs of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And I want to say right up front that this is not necessarily about the federal government. It is about the state of Massachusetts. And I think that we have always stood for democracy, privacy, all of the things that our country is founded on. So what our role is to look forward and unfortunately have to react to some things that may potentially compromise what the state of Massachusetts stands for.
So, for example, on immigration, I mean, one of the concerns that I know a lot of people have about deporting people that might be here illegally mm-hmm. is that if they have children that were born in this country, but the parents weren't, if you deport the parents, mm-hmm. then you can tear
right.
families up in that way.
Right. Right.
So is that some of those kinds of things as long
I think
as well
we will
as some
probably
of the
get to that eventually. Mm-hmm. That is, it's a very, you know, very candidly, that's a very hot button issue. Mm-hmm. I don't think that people should break the law. I don't think anybody thinks people should break the law. But then, you know, in my heart of hearts, do I want to tear up families? No, I don't. So there has to be a policy for people to move towards citizenship. But at the end of the day, this is a problem. People should not be coming to this country illegally. And yet, they do. They do because it's better than where they're living.
So we kind of live in an age of cynicism, mistrust of government, and many people are wondering whether they should get involved, particularly women. If you could have some advice for them or offer some insight about why it's important for them to get involved in the process, what would you say?
Well, first of all, it's important to get involved in the process because, as I've said repeatedly, even in this short time, we know that the research tells us that when women and men are involved in a process, success comes at a higher rate. Success comes in with people doing better economically. So we know these things. Now, how do you say to a woman, we're asking you to take a lot of time away from your family? We're asking you to have a little thicker skin because, you know, we kind of naturally want people to like us. And it does hurt when we know that somebody doesn't like us, but it's, you know, it is what it is. So in talking to women and speaking with them and asking them to consider it, that's part of the conversation. First you lead with the positive. All of the things that you can do, what you would contribute, not that, 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 that. And then you actually have to say to people, look, it's going to be hard. you're going to take time away from your family. Know that campaigning can be very difficult. Know that there are going to be people who don't like you and they're not going to be nice about it. And know that your family's going to be affected by that. It's not nice, it's not good, but again, it is what it is. And we have found that, you know, recently, it seems okay to call names. It seems okay to involve somebody's family. You know, that's completely off limits to me. People have made comments about the president's youngest son. That is off limits. That is not allowed. I don't care what you think of him. I don't care what you think of anything. You are not allowed to bring his son into this. And I would prefer if you didn't bring his family either, but they're adults and so at some level they are involved. But it is true right down to the local level. I never think that families and kids should be part of the conversation. But over the years, that's changed, unfortunately, and not for the better.
So, I mean, in many respects, having support through things like the Women's Caucus can be helpful to deal with the trolls on Facebook or on, you know, Twitter, sending things out that are really nasty, that, to provide that kind of support.
It is. You know, you've got to say, hey, they said it about me. Or very often, we'll send something and say, well, here's what I got hit with today. And it's, you know, a little commiserating because it's happening even to the men. And don't tell me that they're not on, you know, sitting together or at the golf course or at some event and saying, oh, did you see what I got in my email today? And you know, they'll be very bravado about it. It doesn't bother them. But I'm sure that everyone, I don't care, you're human, it hurts a little.
Well, that'll have to be the last word. So thank you so much for joining us today to talk about women in politics.
Thank you. It was great. I really enjoyed it.
So thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next time on Commonwealth Politics.